Hello there. 6 years ago, I made a video that to this day is the second most viewed video on this channel. It was about this jar in which I collected runoff water, giving one of the most memorable quotes of this channel.
But always remember, never let what anyone thinks stop you from putting rainwater in a jar.
Words to live by. I talked a lot about rainwater in that video, and I even titled this video Rainwater. A lot of viewers at that time felt bamboozled because they were expecting it to be about pure rainwater. Well, just to be clear, we are talking about rainwater that already fell. For that project, I collected runoff water from various places, and that looked like this. I managed to collect rainwater from various pots on my parents' roof terrace. I also scooped up some rainwater from my parents' neighbor's roof, as well as the gutters. I also got some of this brown stuff, which is a mixture of soot and other gross big city particulates, as well as maybe some traces of organic matter, like old leaves and bird poop, which formed this goop after many cycles of raining and drying. In the rainwater, and in the jar, this is the life that we could see. In some rainwater I collected but did not add to the big jar, there were mosquito larvae and pupae, as well as a lot of really big rotifers. This is the rainwater ecosphere. The water had a yellow tint to it. The water column at this point was also full of rotifers, swimming around. On the glass we could see a paramecium gliding about, as well as clumps of the dark gutter goop. And this is all I filmed in between then and the present time. This is 3.5 months after the ecosphere was closed. The jar wasn't clear anymore, due to algae and biofilm growing on the glass. There also weren't many rotifers swimming around anymore, or they were just less visible. And that's all the old footage I have of this closed ecosystem. Let's take a look at what it looks like from the outside now. This is what it looks like nowadays. There's a biofilm all around the glass and it looks like it also has some patches of algae in it. As you can see, it's currently not attached to the glass, as it's waving in the water, but that hasn't always been the case. There is this line going diagonally through the jar dividing two types of biofilm, one with lots of algae patches and one with little. This seems to be also a biofilm, or maybe a more accurate term would be microbial mat. It must be quite thick because it blocks most of the light, also explaining the lower concentration of algae below it. There seem to be some bubbles, but it's hard to see. Luckily, we can open it in a second. Also, trying to get any information about the ecosystem by pointing a macro lens at the glass, something I so often have to do, doesn't always work really well. Luckily, we can open it in a second. This solves so many problems. It's great. It looks pretty abstract and cool though. What we can see is that there's not a lot of rotifers and paramecium swimming and gliding around anymore. I haven't seen any. So that's what it looks like now. A little ecosystem in a jar, closed airtight for 6 years. That brings me to the main topic of this video, opening the jar. I actually want to open this jar because I'm very, very curious to see what kind of microbial activity there still potentially is. And in the past years, I've been able to buy a very nice microscope with the help of my dear patrons. Thank you guys, I really love you. I actually want to look at the microbial life in almost all my other ecosystems, but for most of them, I think opening would be a really great shame because some of them have been experiments that have been running for years. I've been looking at this jar for years as well, and I can tell you that it is pretty much stable. At least visually, nothing has really changed over the years. And therefore I decided to sacrifice it to satisfy my curiosity. Well, enough beating around the bush. The time has come to finally open it. I'm actually a bit nervous to open it. I mean, I've held it closed deliberately for the past 6 years. Make a lot of closed ecosystems after all, so it just feels a bit wrong. I mean, it's irreversible once it has been opened. It's not a closed ecosystem anymore, at least not for the past 6 years, only from the new point. I'm not too worried about a bad smell or that a newly evolved pathogen could kill me. I've opened jars before and they usually don't smell bad at all. I mean, I even drank one at some point. Cheers. It's actually interesting to me that that video didn't do too well, while a video about a jar of dirty old rainwater got so popular. See what's happening here. I'm trying to postpone the inevitable. Well, here we go, I guess. It's open. Now, first, I'll do this the scientific way so that I don't burn my nose hairs off if anything is really wrong. Yeah, just like I thought, it doesn't really smell like anything. And the water is actually crystal clear, I'll show you in a minute. It's only like the biofilm on the glass that is causing it to look like it's really dirty, but the water is actually quite clean. Well, it's not neutral. It's also not gross, but it's not just straight tap water. Don't do that at home, kids. That's actually really irresponsible and stupid of me. But I think I've trained my immune system quite well. But don't do it, seriously. Yeah, it's clean. There doesn't look to me like there's too much large microbes in it. Actually, this is kind of crazy. I'm seeing a springtail on the water surface. I'm not sure it's alive though, we'll take a closer look in a second. That would be actually crazy. But other than that, the water is quite clear and there's a lot of biofilm and algae growth. So we'll take a closer look.
No way, there's actually a living springtail in here. That's baffling, that's mind-blowing. I don't know what to make of that. See, now I feel bad that I opened it. That's insane.
It's really cool to see a springtail in here. Not just because I really like them, but also because that means it's been able to survive in here for 6 years. For the past 6 years, this little jar provided a safe living environment with enough food and oxygen, while keeping any toxic gases or other substances at a sufficiently low level. There must have been at least one springtail present in this jar from the start, or at the very least, an egg. Unfortunately, the video quality is not great, and I did not want to risk losing or harming the springtail by taking it out. So identification was difficult, but I tried anyway. I think it could very well be one of these three species. Here's a top-down view of the now green jar. There were indeed some bubbles near the water surface, trapped under a thin biofilm that formed on top of the water surface. The water itself is crystal clear. This is a microbial mat growing in the middle of the jar, which we saw from the side earlier. It is indeed very thick. I think this was originally a biofilm that grew on top of the small layer of dirt on the bottom of the jar, that later floated up, at least halfway, and over time grew into a thick microbial mat. It's very difficult to grab hold of because it's really slippery and also really sturdy. It has an almost rubber-like feel to it. Moving a bit of biofilm to the side caused a lot of water to flow throughout the jar, showing that there are still a lot of particles on the bottom. The film on the glass has grown into one connected sheet covering the entire jar, and it's also much thicker and sturdier than I'm used to from other biofilms. On top of the water, there's another little patch of microbial mat growing, and on top of that, or growing out of it, are these little bright green nodules. I have no clue what these are. Well, I think the time has come that we, you know, take a bit of a closer look.
The first thing I want to see under the microscope is some water from the bottom of the jar and, as usual, I'm filming this very poorly. Right, here's what we can see. All the little black specks, the little sausages, are bacteria. The light greenish oval shapes are probably algae cells or algae cysts. In the sample, there's quite a few of these brownish blobs, which I think is an agglomerate of many different things, including algae and dust, or small bits of that dark sludge. Here's a collection of many tiny things, maybe bacteria, I'm not sure. Here, hidden in some particles, is a little ciliate. It was swimming freely right until the moment I started filming. Maybe a bit of stage fright. This large coiled thing, moving through the water like a corkscrew, is a bacterium. More specifically, it's a spirochete. They have a unique way of moving, as you see, by literally screwing themselves through the water. Most species are free living, like the one you're seeing, but some are pathogenic, and they're actually able to corkscrew themselves through cells. Most free living species are actually anaerobic, but this one isn't. The water does not seem to be anaerobic. In the upper left corner, you can see another spirochete. And I saw quite a lot of these things. They don't move, so they might be dead microbes or some sort of cyst. I also want to take a look at this biofilm that's growing near the glass. Of course, I'll take a smaller piece than this. Magnified 63 times, we are immediately greeted with some rotifers. What do you know? I saw them instantly while I intended to look at the biofilm. And then I just saw them there. The biofilm itself is made up from all these interlocking threads, which is pretty cool to see. It's almost like a fabric. I'm not sure what these threads are made of. Maybe they're fungal threads, bacterial colonies, but probably some sort of extracellular compound secreted by a microbe. Here it is at a higher magnification. You can clearly see the threads and even the frayed edges. It was actually quite difficult to tear apart. Here we have one of the rotifers, sometimes also known as wheel animals or wheel animalcules. There's actually quite a lot of them in this sample, but I couldn't see any of them with the naked eye. This must mean it's not the same species as we saw 6 years ago, even though they look really similar. Of course, I didn't have a microscope 6 years ago, so it's a bit hard to compare them. The one you're looking at is definitely a rotifer in the order of Bdelloida, and the ones from 6 years ago are also in the order of Bdelloida, based on their morphology and the fact that we could see them crawl, not just swim. The order of Bdelloida contains around 300 known species, so that narrows it down a bit, but not a lot. They even both have an orange gut. The only problem is that they differ quite substantially in size, so they must be different species. It's really cool that closing a jar of runoff water resulted in a closed ecosystem that could harbor and sustain such life forms, and even higher ones like the springtail, for 6 years. An intricate balance has formed in the jar between the primary producers, in this case algae, taking up nutrients and carbon dioxide while producing oxygen, between heterotrophic microbes and even animals using oxygen and producing carbon dioxide while feeding directly or indirectly on the primary producers, and decomposing organisms, mineralizing dead matter, or sometimes living matter, into nutrients the primary producers can use to grow, closing the loop. Inside a jar of runoff water, for 6 years. Wild. Fun fact, Bdelloids are actually the highest life forms that we know of that don't have any sexual reproduction. I also wanted to take a closer look at the really thick microbial mat dividing the jar in two, which proved to be a bit challenging as it was really thick. Did I already mention that? So here it is. Visually, it doesn't look much different from the other biofilm, just a lot thicker. Did I already mention it was thick? So I don't think I could say, based on visual information alone, whether or not this was made by a different species or a different combination of species. This one's really thick, by the way. In the water next to it, we can see something swimming around with flagellae, which is interesting and could be a whole bunch of different things in multiple kingdoms of life. Growing in or on the biofilm is this very round cell. I'm colorblind, so I can't really tell whether it's red or green, but I think it's red, in which case it could very well be Haematococcus, which is an algae and is responsible for the pink color of flamingos. In that case, this would be a cyst. If it's green though, it could be a cyst of a different algae like Chlamydomonas. So, those were the secrets revealed by a microscopic view. I am pleasantly surprised by the amount of life we could see through the microscope. Makes me wonder about my other jars. No, I shouldn't. There were rotifers. Those are really cool and big microbes. The algae must have provided enough oxygen for them to live, as well as food. Although rotifers also do eat a lot of detritus and dead organic particulate matter like bacteria and other microbes. The algae obviously also provided enough oxygen for the springtail, as well as for all the other aerobic bacteria and archaea we could see swimming around. There were a lot of those black little wiggly things. Those were all bacteria or archaea. Oh, and then there were the spirochetes, really cool bacteria. Though some do cause nasty diseases like relapsing fever, Weil's disease, Lyme disease, and syphilis. And I just drank some. I'm not really worried though. I'm not even sure if the ones we saw caused disease. There wasn't a high concentration of them, and most of these diseases are caused by bacteria entering the bloodstream. Still, it does illustrate that I made an unwise decision. There's actually still a lot of life in this old jar of dirty rainwater. And I actually think I'm going to close it again. I don't regret opening it because we saw a lot of cool stuff, but it would be nice to see how long this will actually last. There. Let me know what you guys think. Well, I think that's it. Bye.